What is the fundamental nature of randomness? Is pi random? Is random.random random? And do I have to learn the riffle shuffle? These are the questions that Avi Wigdorsson studied his whole life. Okay, maybe except for the last one. For decades, he studied the fundamentals of randomness and pseudo-randomness. A month ago, this earned him the Turing Award, the most prestigious prize in computer science. We decided to use this opportunity to explain his perhaps most important contribution, how to make any randomized algorithm deterministic. Before we start proving theorems, let me give you a few examples that show how Avi Wigdorsson's work influenced how I personally think of randomness. Think of a card game like poker. In poker, you need to shuffle the cards between rounds so that the rounds don't influence each other. If you're just playing at home, you'll probably be shuffling using a simple method like the so-called overhand shuffle, but that technique is actually quite bad. I started with a sorted deck, shuffled for like a minute, and you can still see that the deck isn't properly shuffled. That's why dealers at casinos use more fancy methods like the riffle shuffle. But the question is, if you're just playing for fun at home, does it actually matter that your deck isn't properly shuffled? Realistically, among casual players, nobody will be good enough to exploit this. In other words, the overhand shuffled deck behaves essentially the same as a properly shuffled one, as long as the players around the table only use simple strategies to play the game. Similarly, when working with algorithms, you sometimes need to use random bits. However, generating truly random bits can be slow, because it involves your operating system gathering noise by monitoring hardware components. So it's much more practical to instead use fake randomness provided by a so-called pseudo-random generator. This is a function that applies complicated transformations to an initial seed value. This way, it produces a sequence of bits that looks totally random, even though it's a deterministic function of the seed. It's the same principle as in the poker example. Although our sequence of bits doesn't satisfy the mathematical definition of being random, the pseudorandom function is constructed in a way where taking advantage of the fact that the sequence is not random is a very hard computational problem. You can also think of a coin flip. If I were able to exactly measure how the coin is moving in the air, I could predict which side it lands on. But since I cannot do that, the coin flip is random to me. What these examples show is that from a computer scientist's point of view, randomness at its core is often not about debating whether the underlying physical laws are deterministic or not. Often, a more useful way to look at it is that the bits are random to you if you cannot exploit the way they were generated. This perspective on randomness as being relative to the observer allowed Avi Wigdorsson to prove a very surprising result in complexity theory. Together with Noam Nissan, and building on earlier work by a bunch of other people, Wigdorsson proved the following theorem that says that under an assumption that most people believe, any problem that can be solved efficiently with randomness can also be solved efficiently without it. The conclusion of the theorem, stated more precisely, is that P equals BPP. So let's define what these mean. First, P is the class of all problems that can be solved in polynomial time. It includes problems like sorting numbers or finding the shortest path in a graph, and it's the P from the famous P versus NP question. Second, BPP stands for bounded probability polynomial time, and it's the class of problems that can be solved with algorithms that only use polynomial time, but that can additionally use randomness, and we require them to be correct with only, say, 99% probability. Here's a typical problem in BPP. You're given two polynomial expressions, and you need to figure out if they correspond to the same polynomial, meaning, if you multiply out all the parentheses, will you arrive at the same expression? For these simple expressions, we can just solve the problem by doing exactly that. In this case, we find that they are indeed equivalent. But in general, the exponents in the two expressions can be really large, and multiplying them out takes time that's exponential in the length of the input. In other words, this naive algorithm does not run in polynomial time. Fortunately, even for these two monstrous expressions, there's a simple way to test whether they correspond to the same polynomial. We can simply generate a random integer and plug it into the two expressions. Because the result can be really large, we'll only compute it modulo some large prime, in this case 1,000,000,007. In this example, the two results we got are different, meaning that the two expressions clearly don't correspond to the same polynomial. But what if the two results happen to be the same? Then we can be quite confident that the two expressions are equivalent. But it's only a probabilistic statement. Even two different polynomials can give you the same outcome for certain values of x. In other words, even different polynomials can intersect. But we can use the fact that two distinct polynomials of degree d have at most d intersections. So we can just sample the random evaluation point from a range that's large enough so that it will be very unlikely that we hit one of these D points. And that way, we'll make the success probability of the algorithm at least 99%. So the polynomial testing problem can be solved efficiently, that is, in polynomial time, using a randomized algorithm. However, it's not clear at all how to solve it with a fast deterministic algorithm. That's why in the 80s, many researchers suspected that P is not equal to BPP. At first glance, there's just no reason why you should be able to convert randomized algorithms into deterministic ones in full generality. So it was shocking when Nissan and Wiglerson proved that P is equal to BPP under an assumption that most researchers believe to be true. I'll try to give you a rough idea of how to prove their theorem. In a nutshell, the idea is to take any randomized algorithm and instead of having it use truly random bits, use bits from a carefully constructed pseudo-random generator. To understand the proof, we need to talk about pseudo-random generators. As we mentioned, a pseudo-random generator is a function that receives a seed consisting of a few random bits. In our case, a few means on the order of log n. The generator takes this seed and spends polynomial time to output n bits that look random. For different seeds, the output is different, but it's a deterministic function, meaning for the same seed, we'll always get the same bits. But what the heck do we mean by look random? If you're given a string of bits and you're supposed to decide if it's random or not, it's impossible to do that with absolute certainty. After all, even a string of all zeros could have been selected randomly, it's just very unlikely. But you can use statistical properties of random strings to design tests that can detect when a string is not random with good accuracy. Perhaps the simplest test is to just count how many zeros and ones the string contains. In a truly random string, both digits usually occur roughly 50% of the time. So we can simply flag sequences with a significant imbalance between zeros and ones as not random. As you might expect, this statistical test is not very good. For example, if we generate a pseudo-random bit string by alternating zeros and ones, we pass this test. It labels our string as random, although it wasn't generated randomly at all. But there are much more powerful statistical tests as well. For example, counting the bigrams in the string would already recognize that the string with alternating zeros and ones is not random. By the way, if you try to create a random-looking sequence of bits by just manually writing zeros and ones, this test would probably already catch you, despite being so simple. Of course, in practice, pseudo-random generators are tested using many other statistical tests. Some of these are really fun. One involves using the generator to simulate games of craps and checking if the number of wins follows the expected distribution. Now, remember how I said that the pseudo-random bits should look random? What I meant by that is that good pseudo-random bits should pass as many statistical tests as possible. Here's a generator that does well in this regard. One that simply outputs the first n digits of pi. We'll use the decimal digits in our animations because they look more familiar than pi's binary digits. The digits of pi behave randomly, in a sense, so this generator would pass most standard statistical tests. But it has an obvious flaw. Consider a test that simply checks whether the input sequence is equal to the first n digits of pi. This test will be able to consistently separate truly random bits from bits coming from this generator. The issue is that our pi-based generator isn't using the random seed, so let's upgrade it. The new version of our generator first looks at the random seed and interprets it as a random number k. Then, it computes the digits of pi until it reaches position k. Finally, it reads the next n digits and returns those. If we want to generate n random digits, we'll choose the number k randomly between 1 and n to the 10th. That means that we'll go very deep into pi to generate our pseudo-random digits. This pseudo-random generator isn't practical because generating the first n to the 10th digits of pi would take a lot of time. But there is something very curious about it. How would you design a statistical test that could distinguish between the bits from this generator and truly random ones? You could try to upgrade our earlier pi detecting test. Namely, generate n to the 10th digits of pi and try to find the input string in it. This statistical test can flag the pseudo-random bits coming from our pi-based generator, but the catch is that the test also needs a lot of time, n to the 10th. What about tests that are faster than that? Those don't have the time to check all the digits of pi, so it's plausible to conjecture that our pseudo-random bits passed all tests that run much faster than n to the 10 steps. This relates to what we talked about at the beginning. Although these bits aren't random, distinguishing them from truly random ones is very difficult, computationally speaking. The Nissan-Wiglerson generator is similar to our pi-based one. If you specify some polynomial function, like n to the 10th, The generator outputs n pseudorandom bits that pass all statistical tests running in time n to the 10th. The generator itself uses more than n to the 10th time, but since it still runs in polynomial time, that's enough for our theoretical purposes. The big advantage of the Nissan-Wigderson generator is that we can actually prove that it has this property, given a very plausible, though yet unproven, assumption in complexity theory. This is actually the hardest part of the P equals BPP proof, and we won't go into it here. In the case of the pi-based generator, it's very difficult to see how you could prove this formally, even though it might be true. Okay, now that we have this powerful pseudorandom generator, we can prove that P equals BPP. Let's demonstrate this on the randomized algorithm we saw earlier for checking whether two polynomial expressions are equal. Let's call this algorithm A and we'll represent it with a box with two input wires, one for the actual input and one for the random bits. Our next goal is to prove that A behaves similarly if we run it with pseudorandom bits rather than truly random ones. Remember, if the two expressions do correspond to the same polynomial, then it doesn't matter whether we use truly random or pseudorandom bits. We could even use the all zero string. The algorithm just plugs a certain number into the two expressions, arrives at two identical results, and then correctly answers that these are the same polynomial. So on these inputs, our algorithm is always right. So let's focus on the interesting case where the two expressions are not the same polynomial. In that case, if we run our algorithm with truly random bits, it correctly classifies the two expressions as different with 99% probability. I will now show that if we run A with bits from the Nissan-Wigderson generator instead, it's correct with a probability of at least 1%. That might not sound like a lot, but it will be enough. Assume for contradiction that there is some concrete input where A with pseudorandom bits is correct with less than 1% probability. In other words, it incorrectly classifies the two expressions as being the same with more than 99% probability. If this happens, we can turn our algorithm into a statistical test. Here's how. We simply run A on this concrete input using the supposedly random bits. If A correctly identifies the two polynomial expressions as being different, the statistical test answers that the bits are random. This makes sense because we know that for truly random bits, A is correct with at least 99% probability. So truly random bits are almost always classified correctly. And if A incorrectly answers that the two expressions are the same, the test answers that the bits are not random. And we assumed that on this input, the Nissan-Wigderson pseudorandom bits make A answer incorrectly with at least 99% probability, so our test correctly classifies these bits as not random. So we just constructed a very accurate statistical test that can distinguish between truly random bits and bits from the Nissan-Wigderson generator. However, Nissan and Wigderson proved that no such statistical test can exist. This is a contradiction with our assumption that A is correct with less than 1% probability. In other words, even if we run A with pseudo-random bits, it must still sometimes answer correctly, although the probability of success may have gotten smaller. That was a lot, so here's a high-level recap. We have the Nissan-Wigderson generator, which generates bits that are indistinguishable from truly random ones by any fast statistical test. We take any algorithm that solves a BPP problem, and instead of running it with truly random bits, we run it with pseudo-random ones. And then we observe that if the algorithm behaves sufficiently differently in the two scenarios, we get a fast statistical test able to detect bits coming from the Nissan-Wigderson generator. But that's not possible. Therefore, for any algorithm in BPP, these pseudorandom bits must be good enough. So after all this hard work, we've proven that if we start with a randomized algorithm that succeeds with a 99% probability, we can run it with pseudorandom bits and it'll still succeed at least 1% of the time. Notice that even if we run A with pseudorandom bits, the algorithm is still randomized because we need to seed the pseudorandom generator. But remember that the seed is very short. In the case of the Nissan-Wigderson generator, the seed only has O of log n bits. This means that we can now create a new algorithm that literally iterates over all possible seeds, and for each seed, runs A with pseudorandom bits generated from that seed. If, for at least one seed, A finds out that the two expressions are different, the new algorithm also answers that they're different. Since the seed is so short, this new algorithm still runs in polynomial time. And since A is correct for at least some seeds, our final algorithm is also correct. So apart from the assumption needed to prove that the Nissan-Wigderson generator fools statistical tests, we've proven that any randomized algorithm can just as well be run with these pseudo-random bits. A variant of this algorithm works in full generality and proves that P equals BPP. Again, conditional on the assumption that we've been mentioning. There is, of course, much more to Avi Wigerson's work than de-randomization. One of my favorites is his work on cryptography, in particular on zero-knowledge proofs. Let me explain the gist of those. Yesterday before bed, I solved this extremely hard Sudoku, and I want to persuade you that I solved it without spoiling the solution. A zero-knowledge proof is a protocol that we can run together, such that at the end of it, you'll believe that I've solved this Sudoku, but you will have learned nothing else about my solution. I mean, how cool is it that this is even possible? It's one of those times when mathematics really seems like a magic trick. And it's a useful magic trick too. Zero-knowledge proofs are extremely helpful subroutines in a lot of cryptographic protocols. Pseudorandomness has been one of the most challenging topics that we explained here at Polylog, so if something didn't make sense, don't worry and let us know in the comments. We hope you enjoyed the video, and see you next time!